Analysts saying we got to start with the bigger story, that Facebook's ad business is not going to stand up to this crisis. How well positioned do you think their business model is right now if there's a massive economic slowdown?
Well, their business model is fairly well positioned. Everyone's going to be taking a hit from this thing. But when advertisers decide when they have to reach someone, Facebook is the one of their few choices to reach mass audiences through the internet, and through mobile phones in particular. So I think that they're going to suffer like everyone else, but time and time again, we've seen that no matter what the other problems Facebook is having, it's the ads that keep driving up and up.
So you started this book in 2016 before the presidential election had happened. At that point, you had to pivot massively because Facebook suddenly became, as you called it, the most reviled company in the world. How did you turn your reporting process a 180 degrees?
Well, fortunately, it happened pretty early in my research. I started researching this book at the end of the summer of 2016. I actually went to Africa, to Nigeria with Mark Zuckerberg. And it was interesting because it turned out I was witnessing peak Facebook. His popularity was never higher. Even though Facebook had had issues in the past and problems and criticisms, it was skating by all of those. And it was a beloved company. And then with the election in November 2016, things took a turn, and everything that people didn't like about Facebook, they learned more about. And there was a series of scandals culminating in Cambridge Analytica. So it actually was fascinating to, during most of my research, to watch all these things happening. And it refocused what I did, weirdly in a way, to look much more earlier into Facebook's history, because I really wanted to find out the roots of what went wrong. And I was able to dig up a lot of stuff that people hadn't seen before in retelling the early days of Facebook.
Now, a lot has been made of you getting unprecedented access to Facebook employees, to Zuckerberg, to Sandberg. It makes for some incredible color, but you wonder about if that access came with a level of bias towards the company. And how do you respond to the criticism that this isn't the inside story, this is Facebook's side of the story?
Right. Well, there were no strings attached. Facebook didn't see the book until a couple weeks ago. I dropped off a finished version. Too late to change anything, Mark. And I think if you're writing something about a company and wanting to get the full story, how would you turn down the ability to talk to the people and get it from their lips? I've been a reporter for quite a while. I know when I'm being spun. And it wasn't just Facebook people I talked to. I talked to all the people I would have spoken to if I were doing a story from the outside. So it was pure benefit.
Now, you do a lot of getting inside Mark's head. And I'm curious, after all the conversations you had with him, what is your conclusion? Is he somebody who sort of accidentally stumbled on world domination and is consistently surprised by the negative consequences of it? Or did he intentionally seek out that kind of power, that kind of domination, and now revel in it?
Well, he's a person who, to put it mildly, likes power. You know, in his early youth, he played Civilization, a game where you dominate a world. He loved the game of Risk. And he played the college market when he first started the Facebook in 2004, like a game of Risk. He went from college to campus, taking it over. And then when he had Facebook, same thing. The world was his risk board as he went from country to country. I don't think that that precludes some idealism, but it was sort of a mix of saying he believed that Facebook could be a force for good, but he was definitely driven by competition and power and the kinds of things that would drive it out there to overlook things in terms of warning signs that they came up. So he blew past those warning signs, and that's on him.
So is he naive, or is he just, you know, in this ending quest for power?
I think sometimes he tries to cite naivete, but I don't buy it. And I even said that to him, at one point, saying, I'm not taking the we were just kids in a dorm room excuse. He came to Silicon Valley, got in touch with some of the smartest people in the industry. They funded him. He hired great executives like Sheryl Sandberg. So you can't call that naivete. They just prioritize growth higher than they prioritize being careful on how they grow.